At first, you would think that thick wire loom isn't a huge deal on a 3D printer, but depending on the setup, it can make your printhead flex so much that it will start heavily affecting your print accuracy. In my case, on this Voron 0.2, the difference between X and Y axis print lengths is almost half a millimeter, which is just unacceptable for practical prints that require correct tolerances. Considering that good printers have no more than 4 times lower inaccuracy, something is definitely not right here. But is it actually the thick wire loom problem, or is it the issue of cheap linear rails? But maybe it is the lightweight beam? Or is the main plastic part is not rigid enough and we need one from aluminum? And what about the canvas, which requires only 4 wires? Well, let's find out. This is Voron 0.2 that Fysetc sent to test. I enjoyed the build process as it is such a tiny printer and it is easy to work with, but I had a lot of problems with the kit. More on that later. While the thick wire loom felt way too stiff and resulted in heavy printhead tilt, during the build I noticed that linear rails seemed too loose. That looked like the main issue, as all the rails had a significant play in them. To be honest, I was shocked how loose they were. Surely this is the main cause, because the printhead rides on a single carriage and any play in it will be amplified with the nozzle sitting further away from the carriage. My suspicion was somewhat confirmed by the terrible input shaping results, as the y-axis had 3 peaks instead of 1 and recommended max accelerations were abysmal compared to what truly a small printer like this should be capable of. So I ordered a lightly preloaded linear rail, which means that ball bearings inside are just a tiny bit oversized to eliminate any potential play. I ran the input shaping and the prints, and yes, now we're finally getting way cleaner, shaper results with way higher max recommended acceleration. However, to my surprise, the improvement in the print length difference was smaller than I expected, at around 30%, and the main issue still remained unfixed. So it has to be the lightweight beam, right? Well, it weighs 3 times less compared to the regular aluminum extrusion, those 36 grams are almost insignificant. It would be a different story on a bigger size printer where we could save hundreds of grams, but here I would rather have all the rigidity I can. I changed the beam, rerun input shaping, and reprinted the files. This time, although we're getting higher peak values because Clipper just tries to avoid hitting those frequencies with smoothed motion, the overall vibrations are reduced and the max acceleration is increased. We can also see the improvement in 2-axis difference, which was not impressive compared to what a preloaded linear rail gave us, but considering that the 2-axis difference and input shaping results were an improvement of the regular aluminum extrusion, I feel like the lightweight beam is just unnecessary for a stock Voron 0.2, especially considering what the next test part will be. Yes, we're ditching the main plastic piece that the whole printhead is mounted on and changing to a beautiful CNC'ed one that the sponsor of today's video, PCBWay, manufactured. It is made from an aluminum 7075 alloy that is widely used in the aerospace industry as it has an excellent strength to weight ratio. I know, a little bit of an overkill, but this way we'll know if the original plastic part is the weak link and exactly by how much. When I assembled it, it already felt way more rigid, so my hopes are high. But is it just copium, or do we have an actual difference? Well, despite the increase in weight, we get more or less the same max recommended accelerations. But this time we also get a more significant reduction in the printhead flex of an additional 16%. The only odd problem that I encountered with a more rigid aluminum part was that the x-axis input shaping results were flawed. I felt like the rail was binding too much. I'm not sure if that was because of a more rigid part or if the rail just started to fail. So I asked Fysetc for their preloaded linear rail. I have no idea why we don't include at least one rail like this for the x-axis by default, because it felt very smooth and had no play. I ran the input shaping and the prints again, and finally the x-axis results went back to normal. I can't explain why, for example, ZV shaper results got worse and MZV so much better, but luckily the main goal of reducing the printhead flex didn't get worse, as y-axis print length was basically the same. Those differences are margins of error. And finally, ditching off the thick cable and using the canvas, which requires only 4 wires. Well, this is where I stuck so long that it was not even funny. BTT was kind enough to send their EBB36 board and the USB to CANBUS adapter, but I just couldn't get them to work on the Fysetc Catalyst board. I also tried using integrated CANBUS port, but it also didn't work. I talked to Fysetc engineers over a period of 1 month and they released an updated image that fixed the integrated CANBUS problem. I wired everything and was so excited to test when I encountered yet another setback. The CANBUS was overloading the mainboard MCU on simple actions like hitting the printhead and the bed. I just lost hope at this point and reached out to BTT again, and they sent parts for a full motherboard replacement with a Manta E3 Easy board that I used and really liked in one of my previous projects. But of course, like always in life, when you get what you need, you give it one final chance and you find the solution. Turns out that CANBUS rates higher than 250k are unusable on Fysetc board as they overload the MCU. However, the input shaping now seems to be the new issue. I still get great looking prints with previous input shaping values, but my best guess is that CANBUS rate is too low for accurate acceleration measurement. So was all this worth it? Oh yes. The slim and more flexible CANBUS cable reduced the print length difference by another 14% and by more than 60% in total. Now we're reaching levels that are acceptable and even better than some of the consumer grade printers. But yes, they are still not perfect. And things like how well you build it and changing those loose Y-axis rails most likely make the final difference. Summarizing the results, I would say the first and the most important thing here is the preloaded X-axis linear rail. If you're not getting a single peak in your input shaping results, that might be the first indication. Plus, it improved the print accuracy almost as much as all other modifications combined. The next step is 100% the CANBUS that eliminates the thick wire loom. If you are not running the problematic catalyst board, just go for it. Slim and way more flexible cable is the way, especially for smaller Corax Y printers. Just make sure you also eliminate other factors like the heavy rubbing of a PTFE tube and the cable with some sort of top hat extension mod. And finally, a more rigid regular beam with combination of a CNC'ed or 3D printed aluminum part. That would be the last step from these tests for the fast and accurate prints on smaller printers like this Voron Zero. Please keep in mind that these things can have less significant or different effects on bigger printers and especially on bedslingers as their printhead moves only in one axis. So what about the kit? Is it worth it? I don't know how experienced the Fysetc kits can differ so much as I had only few issues with their Voron 2.4 kit, but this Voron 0.2 kit just feels wrong. Printed parts very questionable quality and some of them were not even right for the build, like no holes for the additional extension cables, the too short part where the AC inlet slots in, or the toolhead cover that hits the screws. All inner rails are way too loose, the print cooling fans are so weak that they are not even sufficient for ABS overhangs at full speed, and I had to replace them immediately. The printhead heating fan is with bushings and not ball bearings, the reverse Bowden tube has too small inner diameter of only 2 mm, the top hat is too short and the wire loom and the PTFE tube rubs heavily on the top. And I don't need to talk about the main topic of this video, how much the thick wire loom with a loose rail affected the print quality on this printer. Plus, the included custom hot end is not even high flow rate. I feel like you need to change too many parts on this printer, and even the lower price doesn't make it look like a good deal. So while I liked their Voron 2.4 kit and the value it brings, this Voron 0.2 kit feels like a mess with unnecessary upgrade parts where other types of upgrades would make way more sense. Huge thanks to all the YouTube and Patreon supporters. Don't forget to like the video and subscribe to the channel. That's all from me, and I'll see you next time.